Okay, thank you very much, and thank you for having me. It's wonderful to be here. I had this as a handwritten paper, and I spent the afternoon very rapidly typing it up so it could be shown on the screen. There may be typographical errors because I have not had a chance to check it, but I hope that it will help. In the year 1620, the English philosopher-politician Francis Bacon set out a plan for what was to be a massive work of science entitled The Great Instauration. Dedicated to King James I of England, also James VI of Scotland, who had recently appointed Bacon as his Lord Chancellor, this work was never completed. In his Prolegomenon, however, Bacon railed against traditional ways of knowing that continually mixed up the reality of the world with its configurations in the minds of men. If only the mind were as clear and even as a perfect mirror, then, said Bacon, it would reflect the genuine rays of things. But it isn't. Cracked and deformed by flaws, both innate and acquired by instinct and indoctrination, the mind distorts the images that are cast upon its surface by way of the senses, and cannot, if left to its own devices, be relied upon to deliver a true account of things as they are. There is but one way out of this predicament, Bacon argued, and that is by appeal to the facts. Those, he wrote, who aspire not to guess and divine, but to discover and know, who propose not to devise mimic and fabulous worlds of their own, but to examine and dissect the nature of this very world itself, must go to the facts for everything. Now, Bacon's words have an unmistakable contemporary ring. Today's science continues to found its legitimacy upon its recourse to the data, which are repeatedly checked and rechecked in a never-ending search for truth through the elimination of error. And for the most part, the sciences of mind and culture, psychology and anthropology, have ridden on the back of the same enterprise. That's to say, they've colluded in the division between what Bacon called the world itself, the reality of nature that can be discovered only through systematic scientific investigation, and the various imaginary worlds that people in different times and places have conjured up, and which, in their ignorance of science and its methods, they've taken for reality. Where anthropologists busy themselves with the comparative analysis of these imaginary worlds, psychologists purport to study the mechanisms presumed to be universal that govern their construction. All agree that the realms of reality and the imagination should on no account be confused, for the very authority of science rests upon its claim to disclose behind the homemade figments that the imagination paints before our eyes the facts of what is really there. One can, of course, study figment as well as fact, so as to deliver what many anthropologists still call emic rather than etic accounts. But to mix the two is to allow our judgment to be clouded by error and illusion. For God forbid, as Bacon put it, that we should give out a dream of our imagination for a pattern of the world. Now, I want to argue now in this lecture that Bacon's injunction, which modern science has taken to its heart, has had fateful consequences for human life and habitation. For those of us educated into the values of a society in which the authority of scientific knowledge reigns supreme, the division between the realms of reality and of the imagination has become so ingrained as to be self-evident. The problem, in our estimation, has been one of how to reach some kind of accommodation between the two. How can we make a space for art, for religion, or for the beliefs and practices of indigenous peoples in an economy of knowledge in which the search for the true nature of things has become the exclusive prerogative of rational science? Do we suffer the imagination to persist in our midst or tolerate its penchant for fantasy out of a compensatory wish for enchantment in a world that has otherwise ceased to enthrall? Or do we keep it as a sign of creativity, or as a badge of civilization, or out of respect for cultural diversity, or merely for our own entertainment? Such questions are endemic, yet the one thing we forget in posing them is how hard it is, in our experience, to split the reality of our life in the world, and of the world in which we live, from the meditative currents of our imagination. Indeed, the problem is the very opposite of what we take it to be, not of how to reconcile the dreams of our imagination with patterns in the world, but how to separate them in the first place. Historically, this separation was but slowly and painfully achieved in the religious upheavals of the Reformation and the turbulent beginnings of early modern science, in which Bacon, along with his exact contemporary Galileo, played a pivotal part. But the historical process is recapitulated today in the education of every schoolchild who is taught, on pain of failure in his or her examinations, to distrust the sensuous, to prize intellect over intuition, and to regard the imagination as an escape from real life rather than a way of living with. Almost by definition, it seems, the imaginary is unreal. It's our word for what does not exist. As every modern parent knows, for example, there is no such thing as a dragon. We grown-ups are convinced that dragons are creatures of the imagination. Yet most of us would have no difficulty in describing one, having seen pictures of dragons in the books we read when we were children and that we in turn read to our own offspring. We're familiar with their general appearance: green scaly bodies, long forked tails, flared nostrils, saber-like teeth, and flaming mouths. These monsters roam the virtual terrain of children's literature alongside a host of other creatures of similarly fictive provenance. Some of them, of course, have real zoological counterparts, while the ever-popular Tyrannosaurus rex, perhaps the nearest thing to a dragon that ever lived, is conveniently extinct. Other animals, from cobras to crocodiles and from bears to lions, are still around and occasionally claim human lives. Encountered in the flesh, we do well to fear them. Their fictive cousins, however, give no cause for alarm, for the only people they can eat are as imaginary as themselves. Along with the stuff of nightmares, these creatures are sequestered in a zone of apparitions and illusions that is rigorously distinguished from the domain of real life. We calm the sleeper who wakes in terror at the point of being consumed by a monster with the reassuring words, "Don't worry, it was only a dream." Until the boundary between fact and phantasm, which had seemed momentarily in doubt at the point of waking, is immediately restored. So what then are we to make of the following story, which comes from the life of St. Benedict of Nursia, composed by Gregory the Great in the year AD 594. The story tells of a monk who encountered a dragon. This monk was restless, his mind was given to wandering, and he was itching to escape from the cloistered confines of monastic life. Eventually, the venerable Father Benedict, having had enough of the monk's whinging, ordered him to leave. No sooner had he stepped outside the precincts of the monastery, however, than the monk was horrified to find his path blocked by a dragon with gaping jaws. Convinced that the dragon was about to eat him up, and trembling with fear, he shouted for his brothers to help. They came running, but not one of them could see any dragon. They nevertheless led their renegade colleague, still shaking from his experience, back inside the monastery, and from that day on, he never went astray or even thought of doing so. It was thanks to Benedict's prayers, so the story concludes, that the monk had seen standing in his path the dragon that previously he had followed without seeing it. Well, perhaps the monk of this cautionary tale was merely suffering from nightmares. Medieval people, however, would not have been so readily reassured as their modern counterparts by the realization that in their encounters with dragons and other monsters, what they had seen was but a dream. Of course, they weren't so gullible as to suppose that dragons exist, in the specific sense of existence invoked by modern people when they assert to the contrary that dragons do not exist. It's not as though the monk in our story came face to face with some other creature that, with the benefit of scientifically informed hindsight, we moderns can recognise, say, as a species of reptile. Remember that the brothers who came to his rescue saw no dragon. They saw nothing there at all. What they did see, however, as Gregory's account repeatedly testifies, was that the monk was trembling. No doubt they saw the look of terror etched in his face. And yet when the monk cried out to be saved from the jaws of the dragon, his brothers understood his predicament at once. They immediately recognized in the vision of the dragon the form of the monk's otherwise inarticulable agitation. The monk was on the point of being consumed by fear and already felt the accompanying symptoms of personal disintegration. The dragon was not the objective cause of fear, it was the shape of fear itself. And for the brethren of monastic communities, this shape would have been entirely conventional and well known to all, drummed in through rigorous discipline of mind and body. In this training, stories and pictures of dragons and of other equally terrifying monsters were used, not as we would today, to create a comfort zone of safety and security by consigning everything that might be frightening to the realms of make-believe, but rather to instill fear in novices so that they might experience it, recognize its manifestations, and through a stern regime of mental and bodily exercise, overcome it. As the manifest form of a fundamental human feeling, the dragon is the palpable shape of what it means to know fear. And so in medieval ontology, the dragon exists as fear exists, not as a constituent of the natural world, but as a phenomenon of experience. And as such, it is as real as the sufferer's facial expression and the urgency in his voice. But unlike the latter, it can be neither seen nor heard, save by the one who is himself a fear. And that's why the monk's rescuers saw no dragon themselves. They were most likely motivated by a feeling of compassion, which may for them, in the idiom of the time, have called to mind the image of a saintly figure radiating light. Both saints and dragons, in the monastic imagination, were concocted from fragments of texts and pictures shown to novices in the course of their instruction. And in that sense, to adopt a rather apt term of the historian Mary Carruthers, they were figmented. But these figments of the imagination, far from being cordoned off in a domain separate from that of real life, were for medieval thinkers the outward forms of embodied human experience, lived for them in the space of rupture between heaven and hell. The monk of the story was of course torn between the two. Expelled from the monastery by the saintly Benedict, the devil in the shape of the dragon was waiting for him outside. Rescued in the nick of time, he was led back in. And so the story unfolds along a path of movement, from inside to outside, and then back inside again. From the very beginning, we're told, the mind of the monk was prone to wandering. And indeed, in a puzzling twist at the end of his tale, Gregory recounts that for all that time, the monk was actually following the dragon without actually seeing it. What happened when he stepped outside was a complete loss of bearings, the kind of bodily disorientation that occurs when one is thrust into a totally unknown environment. He panicked, and at that moment the dragon reared up before his eyes, blocking his path, and he found that he could no longer carry on. So in truth, the story concludes, Benedict did the monk a good turn by throwing him out, because it led him to see, and thus to know, the dragon that he had otherwise blindly followed. And for the writers in the monastic tradition, as the narrative brings out so clearly, knowing depended on seeing, and both knowing and seeing proceeded along trajectories of movement. To understand what they meant, we have to think of cognition, as Carruthers explains, in terms of paths or ways. The medieval thinker, in a nutshell, was a wayfarer, who would travel in his mind from place to place composing his thoughts as he went along. Now, I'll return in a moment to the question of wayfaring, but in the meantime, let me introduce another example. Among the Ojibwa, indigenous hunters and tribals of the Canadian North, there is said to be a bird whose sound as it swoops across the sky is a peal of thunder. Few have seen it, and those who have are credited with exceptional powers of revelatory vision. One such, according to the ethnographer A. Irving Halliwell, was a boy of around 12 years of age. During a severe thunderstorm, Halliwell recounts, the boy ran out of his tent and saw a strange bird lying on the rocks. He ran back to call his parents, but by the time they arrived, the bird had disappeared. The boy was sure it was Pinesi, the thunderbird, but his elders were unconvinced. The matter was clinched and the boy's account accepted only when a man who had dreamed of the bird verified the boy's description. And clearly, Pinesi is no ordinary bird, just as a dragon is no ordinary reptile. Like the thunder itself, the thunderbird made its presence felt not as an object of the natural world, but as a phenomenon of experience. It's the manifest form of a sound that reverberates through the atmosphere and overwhelms the consciousness of all who hear it. Just as the monk's brethren, as they rushed outside, saw no dragon, so the boy's parents did not themselves witness Pinesi. But as the conventional shape of what it means to experience thunder, it would have been entirely familiar to them. The thunderbird may be a figment of the imagination, but it is an imagination that has infused the depths of phenomenal experience. Recall that the boy's observation in this case was confirmed by a dream. Bacon would have been horrified. For us moderns, it is more usual and certainly more acceptable for dreams to be confirmed by observation. A well-known, albeit apocryphal, instance is the story of how the chemist Auguste Kekulé dreamt one night in 1865 of a serpent biting its tail while in a whirling movement. He woke, we are told, with a concept fully formed in his mind of the structure of the benzene molecule comprised of a ring of 6 carbon atoms. Subsequent experimental work in the laboratory proved that Kekulé's dream-induced conjecture was substantially correct, and it went on to become a cornerstone of the emerging field of organic chemistry. Of course, what Kekulé actually felt at that moment of waking, we can never know. But we can be sure that once he had turned his mind to chemistry, Kekulé's serpent was already drained of whatever affective or experiential force it may once have carried. It had by that stage become a serpent good to think with, an abstract figure of thought that was peculiarly apt for enrolment as an analogical resource for deciphering the structure of a given reality. So the serpent and the benzene rings fall unequivocally on either side of an impermeable ontological division between imagination and reality. It's this that allows the one to stand metaphorically for the other. Indeed, the congruity between serpent and ring reinforces the division rather than breaking it down. For the Ojibwa, however, it would have been quite otherwise. For them, the truth of things is both found and tested by personal experience, which is why the boy's observation could be corroborated by his elder's dream. In this quest for knowledge through experience, the powerful more-than-human beings that inhabit the Ojibwa cosmos, including thunderbirds, are not analogical resources, but vital interlocutors. This cosmos is polyglot, a medley of voices by which different beings in their several tongues announce their presence, make themselves felt, and have effect. To carry on your life as an Ojibwa person, you have to tune into these voices and to listen and respond to what they're telling you. Another Thunderbird story from Halliwell admittedly one told to him by an informant, perfectly illustrates the point. Halliwell's informant was sitting in a tent one stormy afternoon with an old man and his wife. The thunder rolled and clapped. At once the old man turned to his wife. "Did you hear what was said?" he said. "No," came the reply. "I didn't quite catch it." Commenting on the exchange, Halliwell remarks that the old man was reacting to this sound in the same way as he would respond to a human being whose words he did not understand. But this wasn't a simple failure of translation. It wasn't as though the Thunderbird had a message for the old man that he failed to grasp because of his imperfect grasp of bird language. By and large, Halliwell observes, the Ojibwe do not attune themselves to receiving messages every time a thunderstorm occurs. But it transpires that this particular man in his youth had become acquainted with the Thunderbird through the dreams of his puberty fast and had gone on to develop a close relationship of tutelage with Tinesi. In the context of this relationship, listening and responding to thunder was a matter not of translation, but of empathy, of establishing a communion of feeling and effect, or, in short, of opening oneself up to the being of another. And it's above all in dreaming, where the boundaries that surround the self in waking life are dissolved, that this opening up occurs. But such exposure was not something that a sober scientist like Thackeray could even contemplate. For him, the path to true knowledge lay not in opening up a dialogue with beings of the more than human world, but in an exact and literal reading of the facts already deposited there. The object, as Bacon had put it, was to write a true vision of the footsteps of the Creator imprinted on the works of his creation. It was a matter of unlocking the secrets of nature. For that, you need a key, or rather, several keys, to unlock door after door. Kekule's serpent offered one such key in the figure of a ring, and in his book, The Assayer, dating from 1623, Galileo found his keys in the characters of mathematics, in the triangles, circles, and other geometric figures which comprise its special language. Philosophy is written in this grand book, The Universe, wrote Galileo, which stands continually open to our gaze, but it cannot be understood unless one first learns to comprehend the language and recognize the letters of which it is composed. Now, this idea of the book of the universe, or the book of nature, is of considerable antiquity and was as current among medieval scholars as it was subsequently to become in the rise of modern science. It rested at root on an identity between the work of God in the creation of the natural world and the word of God in the composition of the scriptures. And with this we can return to the monks of the medieval era, for whom, as I've already observed, the meditative practice of reading liturgical texts was a process of wayfaring. Over and over again, they would compare their texts to a terrain through which they would make their way like hunters on the trail, drawing on or pulling in the things they encountered or the events to which they bore witness along the paths they travelled. The word in Latin for this drawing or pulling in was tractare, from which was derived the English treatise in the sense of a written composition. As they proceeded, the various personages whom they would meet on the way and whose stories were inscribed on the pages would speak to them with words of wisdom and guidance to which they would listen and from which they would learn. These were known as the voces paginarum, voices of the pages. Indeed, reading was itself a vocal practice. Typically, monastic libraries were abuzz with the sounds of reading, as the monks, murmuring the voices of the pages, would engage with them as though they were present and audible. To read, in its original medieval sense, was to be advised by these voices, or to take counsel. much as the old Ojibwa man would have been advised by the voice of his mentor, the Thunderbird, if only he had heard what it said. Surrounded by the voices of the pages, as the hunter is surrounded by the voices of the land, the medieval reader was a follower of tradition. In his encyclopedic survey of animals in myth, legend, and literature, Boreas Sachs points out that the word tradition comes from trade, which originally meant track. To study a tradition, Sachs writes, is to track a creature, as though one were a hunter, back through time. Each creature is its story, its traditions, and to follow it is at once to perform an act of remembrance and to move on in continuity with the values of the past. Often, the name of the creature is itself a condensed story, so that in its very utterance the story is carried on. But it's carried on too in the calls or vocalizations of the creatures themselves, if they have a voice, as well as in their manifest visible presence and activity. As a mode or knot in a skein of interwoven depictions, stories, calls, sightings, and observations, none of which is ontologically prior to or in any sense more real than any other, every creature, we could say, is not so much a living thing as an instantiation of a particular way of being alive, each of which to the medieval mind would open up a pathway to the experience of God. And so it was, too, with the letters and figures of the manuscript, which, according to Isidore of Seville, writing in the 7th century, enable readers to hear again and retain in memory the voices of those not actually present. So thus was the book of nature mirrored in the nature of the book, a second nature, if you will, comprised not of works, but of words. Now for Isidore, reading should be done quietly, but it could not be altogether silent, since it depended on gestures of the throat and mouth. This was because at that time, there were no spaces between the words of the manuscript. The only way to read, then, was to read out, following the line of letters, much as one would follow a line of musical notation, allowing the words to emerge or fall out from the performance itself. In the 12th and early 13th centuries, however, there gradually came about a shift towards reading with the eyes alone, unaccompanied by voice or gesture. And what made this possible was the division of the line of text into word-length segments, each of which could be taken in at a glance and with spaces in between. The medievalist and paleographer Paul Sanger has shown how, with such visual reading, the voices of the pages were effectively silenced. As long as everyone in a monastic library was reading aloud, the sound of one's own voice would have sufficed to screen out the voices of others. But as every modern student knows, when one is trying to read silently, the slightest sound can be a source of distraction. So it was that silence came to reign within the cloistered confines of the monastery. But in the world outside the monastery, in lay society, oral reading continued to predominate well into the 14th and 15th centuries. As the historian of cognition David Olson has pointed out, it was the Reformation that heralded the key transition in ways of reading, from reading between the lines to reading what was on them, or from the search for revelations or epiphanies to the discovery of the one literal meaning lodged in the text and available to anyone with the necessary key to extract it. In the early 16th century, Martin Luther urged readers to abandon the dreams and fantasies that their predecessors had found in their attunements to voices that they felt were speaking to them through the pages of the manuscript, and to draw a line in the sand between the given meanings of words and their subsequent interpretations. And from there, it was but a short step to extend the same reasoning from words to works, that is, to the reading of the book of nature. Thus did Bacon, a century later, insist on an absolute distinction between dreams of the imagination and patterns of the world. Now, I'd like to draw attention to, in particular, to three corollaries of this transition in ways of reading the natural world. The first has to do with the imagination of what is yet to come. Reading the voices of nature, of the modern human world, medieval people were advised by them and would follow this advice in parallel with their own experience in laying a path into the future. With a sensibility attuned by an intimate perceptual engagement with their surroundings, they could tell not only what has been, but of what will come to pass. But such foretelling, as Olson shows, has to be clearly distinguished from the kind of prediction to which a scientific reading of the book of nature aspires. For to predict is not to open up a path through the world, but to fix an end point in advance. So where foretelling is guided by a dialogue with nature, prediction is based upon observable fact. Drawing on these facts, it is to speculate about the future rather than to see into it. The second corollary concerns performance. I've shown how, for medieval readers, meaning was generated in the vocal gestural activity of reading out. Doing and knowing here were as clearly coupled as chewing and digestion, an analogy that was explicitly drawn in the ancient characterization of thinking as a process of rumination, like cattle chewing the cud. Moreover, medieval people, as we've seen, would have read the book of nature in the same manner through their practices of wayfaring. And so knowledge of nature was forged in movement, in the course of going about in it. And this knowledge was performative in the strict sense that it was formed through the comings and goings of inhabitants. Reading as performance, in short, was both word-forming and world-forming. As the case of the Ojibwa and the Thunderbird clearly demonstrates, in a way of knowing that is performative, a way that goes along, any boundaries between self and other, or between mind and world, far from being set in stone, are provisional and fundamentally insecure. For a science constructed in the spirit of Bacon, however, knowledge is obtained not in reading out, in performance, but in reading off, that is, in the extraction through some process of decoding or deciphering of what is already given. It is not to follow the trails of a world, it is not to follow the trails of a familiar world that is continually unfolding, but to map a terra incognita that is ready-made. And from the moment when reading out gave way to reading off, the world ceased to offer counsel or advice and became instead a repository of data that in themselves afforded no guidance at all on what should be done with them. The third corollary takes us back to the idea that animals and other beings of the modern human world were known in medieval times by their traditions as skeins of stories, depictions, and observations. To track an animal in the book of nature was like following a line of text. But just as the introduction of word spacing broke the line into segments, so also in the book of nature, creatures began to appear as discrete, bounded entities rather than as ever-extending lines of becoming. So nature thus became amenable to the project not of trail following, but of classification. The lines were broken, but the resulting objects could be sorted and arranged on the basis of perceived likeness and difference into the compartments of a taxonomy. One could speak for the first time of the building blocks of nature, rather than of its weave, and of its architectonics. Nature, in short, was perceived to be built up from elements, rather than woven from lines, not performed, but preformed. And the creatures of this natural world were no longer known as traditions, but as species. Those creatures, however, that were known only by their traditions, and for which no corroborating evidence could be found in the facts of nature, fell through the cracks, or were pushed into the wings, as Michel de Certeau put it in the parallel case of the disappearance of narrative beings, along with the itineraries in which they manifest themselves, from scientific cartography. There are no dragons or thunderbirds in scientific taxonomies. It's not just that they do not exist in the new book of nature, but they cannot do so, since their story-bound constitution is fundamentally at odds with the project of classification. Dragons can be told, but they cannot be categorized. The same, of course, is true of experiences of fear and of the sounds of thunder. But this doesn't make them any less real for a person who is frightened or caught in the eye of a storm. It seems then that as the pages lost their voice with the onset of the modern era, so the book of nature was also silenced. No longer does it speak to us or tell us things. And yet, this allegedly silent nature can be, and often is, a deafeningly noisy place. As the philosopher Stephen Vogel observes, the world of nature abounds in movement and gesture, and much of this movement is manifested as sound. Think of the clap of thunder and the howling of the wind, the cracking of ice and the roar of the waterfall, the rustling of trees and the calls of birds. We may also admit that at one level, human talk may also be understood as vocal gesture, and that the voice manifests human presence in the world, just as the call manifests the presence of the bird and the clap the presence of thunder. On this level, voice, call, and thunder are ontologically equivalent, as the voice is human being in its sonic manifestation, so the call is the bird and the clap is thunder. And yet none of this, Vogel maintains, warrants the conclusion that natural entities actually converse with converse with humans, let alone with one another. And this is for two principal reasons. Firstly, conversation requires participants to attend and respond in turn to one another. Humans do indeed attend and respond to the sounds of nature. They listen out for bird calls and are moved or even terrified by thunder. But does nature, Vogel asks, does nature respond to us? Do the self-speaking entities we attend and respond to in nature ever give us their full attention, engage us, respond to our claims? And the answer, he is convinced, is no. The sounds of nature, he suggests, are more like the commands of a monarch who is deaf to his subjects but compels their obedience. And secondly, a conversation is necessarily about something. It enables participants to compare each other's perceptions of the world in the common task of figuring out how it actually is. Human interlocutors do this, but birds, trees, rivers, thunder, and the winds do not. It's not that they're irresponsible interlocutors, rather, they're not interlocutors at all. For Vogel, then, the silence of nature means that however much noise it makes, it takes no part in the conversations we hold about it. It might sound to us as if nature is speaking, but that is a delusion. I have listened carefully, writes Vogel, and I hear nothing. Recall the old Ojibwe man and the Thunderbird. He thought the thunder was speaking to him, but he couldn't comprehend what was said. Was this a failure of translation, as Halliwell seems to suggest? I've argued that it was rather a failure of empathy. For Vogel, however, had the old man comprehended thunder's speech, he would have succeeded neither in translating it nor in empathizing with it. He would rather have performed an act of ventriloquism. For whereas the translator speaks for another, but in his own tongue, the ventriloquist projects his own words onto a mute object while creating the illusion that it's the object speaking for itself. This charge of ventriloquism is, of course, the foundation for the scientific abhorrence of anthropomorphism, where those who claim empathy with non-human creatures or to know what they're feeling stand accused of merely projecting their own thoughts and sentiments onto their unwitting subjects. It's an accusation, however, that has not gone unchallenged. In an important debate conducted recently in the pages of the journal Environmental Values, Nicole Trent has entered on the other side. She replies that non-humans can and do respond to human voice, gesture, and presence in ways that are meaningful both to them and to us. It's true that non-humans might not compare their perceptions of the environment with humans in a collaborative effort to establish the truth of what is actually out there. But to insist that conversations can only take this form, Trent argues, is to take such a narrow view of conversation that it would exclude most of what we commonly call conversation in the human world. For most people, most of the time, conversation is a matter of understanding what others are telling us, of getting the story right, not of verifying the rightness of the story. So human beings who take it upon themselves to render in words what nature is saying are indeed translators and not ventriloquists. And for Klenk, this is precisely what happens in scientific work. Where this is not the case, she concludes, scientific interpretations would be mere fictions created through dialogue among humans, rather than the results of careful interaction with and observation of components of the natural world. But in this, I think, Klenk is mistaken. For the claim of science is precisely that, as a knowledge practice, it does seek to verify the rightness of the story rather than merely getting the story right. Ever since Bacon, science has insisted on discovering the literal truth of what is there, and thus on the strict separation of fact and interpretation. I'd like to interject a bit here that you've probably heard about the case of these particles that have been found to travel faster than light, causing much consternation. A leader writer in the Guardian newspaper concluded, "In science, facts come first, interpretation comes later on." So that is exactly it, and this is very clearly stated. So we're still there, that there's a strict separation of fact and interpretation. Reading what is on the lines of the book of nature rather than between them, the one thing that scientists do not do is what Klenk proposes as their first priority, to listen to the voices of those beings they interact with. So there is, I contend, a real parallel in the modern constitution between the book of nature and the nature of the book, as a completed work whose contents can be read by those with the experience, with the expertise, I should have said, by those with the expertise to decipher it. The parallel lies in the idea that both are to be read in silence, not as part of an ongoing conversation, but as a record of what has come to pass, of a past that in its objective and objectified forms has turned its back on us, presenting only its opaque outward surfaces for our inspection. As scientists, we are supposed to be producers of knowledge, and in this enterprise, the world furnishes our materials, our data. We survey, like prospectors, and tap what it has to offer, what it yields up to us. And it's this yield that is subsequently processed, or as we rather grandly say, analysed, in the formation of knowledge. And so knowledge is created as a kind of overlay or wraparound on the outside of being. Having silenced the world, we find knowledge in the silence of the book. Indeed, the very concept of the human in its modern incarnation expresses the dilemma of a creature that can know the world of which it is existentially a part only by leaving it. Yet in our experience as inhabitants, moving through the world rather than roaming its outer surface, our knowledge is not built up as an external accretion, but rather grows and unfolds from the very inside of our earthly being. We grow into the world as the world grows in us. And perhaps this grounding of knowing and being lies at the heart of the kind of sensibility we are apt to call religious. In the Reformation, however, religion in a sense turned upon itself, and in its insistence on the literal truth of words and works, it was trumped by the very science to which it gave rise. In any contest over the facts, science is bound to win and religion to lose, leaving the puzzle of why people, including, it must be said, many scientists, tenaciously adhere to representations of reality that are demonstrably false. The real contest, however, I think, lies elsewhere. It turns on the question of whether our ways of knowing and imagining are enshrined in an existential commitment to the world in which we find ourselves. To ask which better represents the world, religion or science, is to assume that they are not, that our ways of knowing and imagining are not enshrined in a commitment to the world in which we find ourselves. But if they are, if our ways of imagining and knowing are enshrined in an existential commitment to that world, then we need to ask instead, what is the nature of these commitments? And how can knowing and imagining let us and the creatures around us actually be? Thank you very much.
Igor se disponibilizou a responder algumas perguntas, se alguém tiver, está bem. Se quiserem fazer a pergunta em português também, Pedro vai traduzir.
Ok, that's it. Thank you very much. Please very much. There are two points. One is about the dragons. The question is by describing dragons as the form of a fear, of a feeling, of a state of my body and mind, am I not eliminating dragons from the outer reality? And this is not a kind of ontological cleaning up, freeing the world of entity in the form of Occam's razor operating in the medieval scene. This is the one point. The second is about the... I was thinking of Galileo, or another mathematician, going out of his cell outside and say, look, I'm seeing perfect circles. I'm seeing the earth circling around the sun. And the passerby says, you see nothing. What's going on? And again, explaining away what's the difference, say, let's put it this way, between the monk's dragon and Galileo's orbits, mathematical things, which of course are not there, and nobody else saw, because they were seen, of course, as facts. Something circling around the Earth. And last, I talking about reading, mathematicians, how do they read a book? I learned, I'm an anthropologist, I'm not a mathematician, but I started to realize that the only way to read a book about mathematics is by closing the book and doing it again. Otherwise, you learn nothing. So, the point of this is, I wonder, is this all fascinating? I only don't see the opposition, dualism between science and religion that you propose. I'm sorry, I took a long time making it.
I just answered this one because you asked so many questions that I'm going to answer them. I'm going to answer them straight away. The first thing is that I think for medieval people, thinking about all sorts of creatures, some of which are quite familiar, like foxes and horses, and others a bit unusual, like dragons, but they would have all these creatures in a bestiary. And a medieval bestiary would be full of all sorts of stories, apocryphal descriptions of something happened, moral tales, perhaps a picture or two, some notes about observations. And the animal was the collection of all these things. And it may or may not sometimes appear in front of people, but that's just one element of the totality which consists of all these stories. And I think that's in a way the answer to it. They weren't cleaning things up. They were just assembling or collecting lots of stories. On Galileo, it might be that the continuities are greater than, or as great as the contrast that I was drawing. However, the question is, what's the difference between Galileo seeing a circle where nobody else does, and the monk seeing a dragon where nobody else does? And I think the difference is this, that Galileo was quite clear that his the circles he saw were, I think, the same kinds of things as Kekule's ring. That's to say that it was a figure that was then recruited to help him understand the world, whereas the dragon was not an analogical resource of that kind. It wasn't part of a language. It was a very direct and immediate experience. I really think there is a difference there. And then the third thing, well, this is a really interesting question: how do mathematicians read books? I don't know, but one thing I'm sure of is that mathematicians are not scientists. There's actually a move in the UK these days to put mathematics along with the arts and humanities, quite apart from the natural sciences. I think that probably answers the question that mathematicians don't read.
Eu vou falar português, vou pedir ajuda, porque é muito difícil pensar noutra língua. It's very difficult to me to express my ideas in English. So, and the translate, because... So, sorry, because it's my tongue language.
I should apologize.
Yes, thank you. A ideia que eu queria transmitir é apenas, já para já, o espanto perante esta comunicação. Eu, aliás, tive uma sensação que estava, digamos, numa cerimónia quase xamânica. You'd like to translate? Não.
Okay.
Ah, ok. Porque, de facto, o que eu senti, eu vou... Possivelmente o que eu vou dizer não faz sentido nenhum. Eu não sou antropólogo, venho de sociologia, estudei o Simondon, andei pela epistemologia, filosofia da ciência, tudo lá que está. Ok. E, portanto, tenho uma certa estranheza relativamente à antropologia. E a ideia que eu tenho, a ideia que eu tenho é que enfim, a sensação que eu tive quando vi esta intervenção, eu penso que isto é uma espécie de antropologia da ciência invertida. Ou seja, a ideia de que a antropologia está a fazer, está a trabalhar sobre si própria. Isto é a ideia de um sociólogo, está a falar. E é um trabalho que me parece fabuloso. Eu só queria indicar, portanto, para já os meus parabéns, né? Estou, digamos, em estado de espanto, quase um espanto xamânico para a sua intervenção. Eu gostava só de chamar a atenção para um momento em que eu senti que há uma afinidade eletiva entre Simondon e o professor, que é esta ideia da separação entre ciência e religião. Ou seja, o medo que muitos antropólogos têm relativamente ao pensamento religioso e mágico e a forma como mistificam a questão da recolha dos dados. Eu acho que a antropologia da ciência, eu disse isso há 3 dias, há um problema edipiano entre os antropólogos da ciência. Eu acho que é necessário matar o pai que é a própria ciência, simbolicamente, como compreendo. E eu aqui remetia para Bacon, já agora só uma questão que tem a ver com Francis Bacon. É curioso verificar que Bacon, quando escreve o Great Inauguration e normalmente o novo órgão, o meu órgão, que é um capítulo, ele interrompe, só escreve o primeiro capítulo do Great Installation, que era uma obra fabulosa, queria instaurar, que era a crítica a Aristóteles, queria instaurar a ciência moderna. É o primeiro texto da ciência moderna, esse texto do Bacon. Curiosamente, ele escreve o primeiro capítulo, abandona o projeto dessa obra de crítica a Aristóteles e escreve um livro fabuloso, que é o primeiro livro de ficção científica. Penso que se passa na Atlântida. Ele inaugura a ficção científica. E, além disso, a tentativa que ele faz de entrar em ruptura com Aristóteles, propondo a tal lógica causal e rebatendo as ciências sociais para uma área do imaginário, quase, a relação da lógica de Aristóteles, não vou agora contar essa história, a relação do modelo, que valoriza a ideia de que não é possível, digamos, falar da causalidade final, da subjetividade. A subjetividade é remetida, digamos, para a área das ciências sociais e, portanto, a procura da medida, seja qualitativa ou quantitativa. E, portanto, a ideia, só para acabar a ideia, é dizer que em Bacon e Aristóteles há uma continuidade em Bacon e Aristóteles, que até certo ponto, o modelo em que se baseia a antropologia moderna é exatamente o modelo de uma lógica europeia, de uma lógica europeia de pensamento, que é necessário, digamos, fazer uma espécie de antropologia interna, ou seja, estudar a filosofia do ponto de vista da antropologia. É a proposta de Simondon, quando propõe uma antropologia da percepção, e quando vai aos gregos antigos e às bases da filosofia moderna. Porque a ciência moderna tem a sua base no pensamento de Aristóteles, e, digamos, nesta lógica da procura, digamos, do facto, da realidade externa. Eu não sei se consigo, peço desculpa, enfim, por esta minha intervenção assim, um bocadinho técnica, mas era esta, digamos, a questão que eu queria levantar. Não sei se é uma questão, mas é um pensamento que eu tenho. Obrigado e thank you. I would like that you could translate my ideas.
Yeah.
I think, yeah, thank you very much. I got some sort of sense of it, and I think that it was a commentary more than a question, which is much appreciated. And I really do appreciate bringing Simon Don in here, because it's an author that I admire very much, and because Simon Don was very important in connection with Merleau-Ponty as well, and part of that tradition, which I've also found inspiring in many ways. I certainly think that it's important to put anthropological thinking, and I suppose in philosophy of science, to put it into a longer historical perspective than is often done. There's perhaps a tendency for people to be concerned with modern thought and the nature of modern thought, and they might then start with the early modern period and forget about the rest. And the reason why I've came to the literature on medieval philosophy, early medieval philosophy, by accident, really, and I found it more and more fascinating and very, very anthropological, because I sometimes feel that people like Isidore Seville and St. Augustine and various other people like that were saying things that resonate very well with my anthropological sensibility. And the nice thing is that they weren't having to argue against modernity, because modernity hadn't yet happened. So you could get a very rich sort of philosophy, which I think is still a very important current all the way through Western thought. So I don't know whether that addresses your comment, but I do think that anthropologists should start reading the medieval philosophers a bit more. They'd find a lot of common ground.
Hello. I need you to help me with an understanding of one topic that you mentioned. But dragons and thunderbirds, they may be fictional or not, but in a way they make themselves present. They are a form of presence. Yeah? And what may enable forms of engagement, as you described. Now, I would like to ask you, how do you see it in relation to what is absent, actually, forms of absences? And I'm particularly thinking about droughts, a climate event that is marked by an absence rather than a presence, and perhaps some other climate effects, not weather, but climate facts. So it seems that it's tremendously difficult to engage with an absence that perhaps it produces the kinds of cultural phenomena related to droughts. If thinking about vacuum, for instance, as a thing that is an absence too, like what Boyle produced, I think it's easier to make sense of it precisely because of the scientific taxonomy. I mean, we don't have to engage with vacuum because of the taxonomy, as you suggested. But now when we get to other forms of engagement, like peasants with drought, it seems that it's much more of a challenge. I want to hear you about it, and perhaps how you see that connected to issues that kind of change. Perhaps.
That's an important and tremendously difficult question. I don't quite know how to answer it, but one thing that came to my mind was that very often in progressive evolutionary or development discourses, absence comes in as defining a state which is prior to a more developed one, or prior to the one that is desired. In the classical anthropological literature on social evolution, hunter-gatherers were defined by the absence of, say, central authority or religious a church or anything like that. In the development of, in child development, I've noticed how, in comparing drawing and writing, a child who can only draw but not yet write the absence of legibility. And I rather suspect that drought is a, or aridity is quite specifically a term that is more used by development experts than it is by people themselves. And people themselves are probably not thinking in terms of absence of rain. For what I know of pastoral people living in relatively arid environments, they're simply following where the water is, where the grass is growing. They know the roots, and they're doing so. But a development expert comes in and says, this is an arid environment. We've got to do something about it. We've got to bring in some water. We've got to dig some wells. And they are, because they think that this is a society that needs to be developed, they're defining its current state in terms of an absence of something that ought to be present. And so I think that's a part of the issue. But there's another part, which is much more complicated, and I haven't worked out for myself. I've been trying to think about what imagination really means. And it can mean lots of things. But it's particularly difficult to... There are cognitivists who argue that we only perceive anything by imagining it in our heads. And then they have a problem with deciding, well, how can you say whether you're imagining something that's actually there, or imagining something that isn't actually there? And so when you imagine something that isn't actually there, they call it an illusion. And so the cognitivists have a huge literature on illusions as the way they deal with absence. And I think that must be wrong. But I'm quite sure about what to do instead, but that's another issue. But I think on the specific question about drought and climate change, I think that notion of absence is very closely bound up to a progressive evolutionary discourse about what is a more desirable and developed condition.
Thank you for the wonderful lecture. I love especially the last part when you related science and religion, and you said that in disputes science is bound to win and religion is bound to lose. And what happens when religion or a specific religious movement gets science help to win a polemics, a debate, that what happens in the field that I do research on, when you talk about abortion, when you talk about human embryo statues, science and religion go together to legitimate the embryo status as a human person, ready, perfect, genetically formed individual. So when you said at the end, why people adhere to representations of reality that are demonstrably false, can you demonstrate this is false? Can you demonstrate that is real? We, the society, several different positions are trying to dispute about what's truth. And it's trying to write in laws the truth. I have only to agree about the commitment. When you said that what we are committed to science, to religion, or to science and religion, the values that move us.
Thanks. That gives me an opportunity to be absolutely clear about what I meant by that bit at the end, which I wrote in the plane last night because it came to me, and I'm not sure that it was as clear as it should have been. There are, as you know, endless popular debates about the relationship between religion and science, whether they're compatible or not, which, and so on. And my feeling is that, by and large, in modern Western societies, such as, I suppose, in the UK at the moment, that these questions are really wrongly posed. That is to say that they're posed on the assumption that knowledge is on the outside of being and is a way of representing what is actually there. And if we start with that assumption about the relationship between knowing and being, if we start with the assumption that knowing is something that one adds on as a set of representations about what is there in the world, and if you then couch the science versus religion debate in those terms, then I think, this is mostly, I think, what is happening. So scientists are saying, actually, we do science, we know what the facts are, we've got a much better picture of what's going on in the world. There are these religion people, some say they don't understand anything. Other people say, well, maybe there's some bits, you know, that religion can do that science can't, and we can put them together. But it's completely wrong, and I think that wrong posing of the question actually goes back to the Reformation. And it was the Reformation way of reading the literal truth of the world that underpinned the rise of modern science as we know it. So that's why I felt that, I said that in a sense, with the Reformation, religion kind of turned on itself, because it created something, science, which was then able to say that religion doesn't produce a very good account. I wanted to turn it the other way around and say that the real question is about how we understand knowledge and imagination as growing from the inside of being, as part of that existential commitment we have because we are beings in the world. And that an important element of religious sensibility is that, although it's not been well formulated, it could perfectly well be an important element of scientific sensibility too. We could have a science that is also based on that kind of commitment. But I think it would be a slightly different science to what we have at the moment, or at least in terms of its legitimation. So the real point, I think, is that the way in which the science versus religion debate is posed, both by theologians and by scientists, is very badly posed, because it rests on an assumption that knowledge is separable from being. It rests on that division between interpretation and the reality of the facts, which is what Luther brought in and came with the Reformation and gave rise to modern science. Or partially.
Thank you very much for being I don't think I know what you are proposing is something deeper than what I keep talking about. I think it's around the notion of empathy with nature and things like that. I'm not going into that. I don't know what to do with that. I think it's very interesting, but What I would like to emphasize is the role of rationalism in science and knowledge in general. I think your talk emphasizes more the empiricist side of science, and not the rationalist side of science. And I think in the first question, this I think appeared. Galileo is more a rationalist. He's not a big kind of talk, I think. So you have different ways of tackling with nature, in the case of Galileo, in the case of Descartes, and all that. So we have different strands in the way thinking, the way we think about how science works or should work, and things like that. And I think about fictionalism also. It's a very fictionalism. I think it's a very important strand in this. So I don't know what would you say about that. But I have a particular case. Maybe you can help thinking about that. You thought, I think you are right in saying that we have to go farther back to make sense of science and all that. And I thought about a special fact of in the 13th century, it's a combination of Aristotelian thesis, and how this started fictionalism. So a kind of Aristotelian realism was changed to a kind of nominalism and fictionalism. You have not to accept the way Aristotle pictured the world, but you are free to imagine different kinds of worlds. And I think this was very important in the rise of modern science. So you have also all this strand in science that goes through fictionalism, nominalism, rationalism. So the picture is... But I know that we're not talking about that exactly.
The picture is indeed much more complicated than I portrayed. But I think many scientists now would probably hold on to some notion of Popper's version of science as the process of conjecture and refutation. And I would say that in that way, try to have both their rationalism and their empiricism at once. They would say that that science is always a two-stage process. First of all, you do your rationalizing, or your fiction, or you have your imaginative hunches, or you just fantasize, and you come up with what they like to call blue skies thinking. It's crazy ideas, and then you try to operationalize them, turn them into hypotheses that could be tested, and take them into the lab and get some data. I think it's probably the mainstream view in science at the moment would be that that you need both of those. You need the conjecture, you need the conjectural work, the free thinking, and you also need the empirical research and data collecting as well, and both of them are valued. So I suppose that there are historical variations in the balance between those two components. But I think that pretty much through the history of science, the two have always coexisted, have they not? That there's the rational bit and the empirical bit, and different ideas about how you might put them together. I feel distinctly uneasy about both of them. I feel uneasy about the rationalism that thinks that the mind can cogitate away without any bearings in the world of which it's a part. And I feel uneasy about the notion that there can be pure facts. So I don't think it really works either. What to have instead, I don't know. It's not a very good answer.
Olha aí.
Congratulations. Parabéns, né, pela palestra. Vou falar em português. Gostei muito da palestra, né? E no começo da palestra, o senhor falou sobre a preocupação que a ciência tem com a verdade, né? Mas a ciência está mesmo preocupada com a verdade. Quer dizer, me parece muito que a ciência está ligada a uma urgência prática, no sentido de que a ciência é um modo de dobrar o mundo para o ser humano sobreviver, assim. E talvez a filosofia estivesse mais preocupada com a verdade do que a ciência. Eu gostaria que você falasse um pouco como é que você vê essa relação entre a urgência prática, né, de se dobrar o mundo, de entender os processos para intervir no mundo, e a suposta verdade, né, que se está buscando.
Very good question, thank you. And I think you might be right. It just happened that I gave a version of this talk at the Conference of Social Anthropologists in Wales, actually, a couple of weeks ago. It was my sort of first attempt at these ideas. And I had an email from Rebecca Allison, who's an anthropologist who works with science. Done work research with natural history in the Natural History Museum, and she wrote me this email saying that in her research on scientific ideas, specifically in natural history, she finds that the scientists seem to be much more interested in issues of planetary salvation than anything to do with what might be really there, and that they are quite prepared to hold on absolutely tenaciously to ideas about how the world is, which fly in the face of everything we might know from experimental work, because it fits in with their image of how the planet is going to be saved. One example of this that she mentioned, that Rebecca mentioned in her mail, was that for a long, long time, biology has held on to an extraordinarily simplistic notion of the role of DNA in life forms and evolution. Although we know 1,000 times over that life is so much, much more complex that none of this works. I mean, it doesn't work. You can't, for example, talk about the DNA of a human being when you realize that a human being is actually an ecosystem with about 1,000 different species in. And we all know that, but the science continues to hang on to a certain kind of narrative against all the odds. So, I think you might well be right. But one thing I don't know in the history of science, I ask people this and I don't get a clear answer, is when was it in history, I think, when was it in the history of the 20th century that people suddenly started talking about science in the singular with a big S? Or even, as they do in the UK now, the science. Is it, the science tells us this? So the science is this thing out there that was unitary, and when everybody knows that what science is millions of practices of people doing different things in different places with very little coherence at all. So there's a very powerful rhetoric which seems to become more and more divorced from the workaday world of actual scientific research. And I think it's that rhetoric that we're concerned with there, that it's very much out of touch with anything that we know from ordinary experimental work.
Cool. Thank you. Thank you very much for a wonderful speech. And I hate to do it, but I have to return back to this this issue of dragons. I'm so interested in dragons. Who's not? They breathe fire, they fly around, like the slave with a big sword. Anyway, what interests me about dragons is that dragons are kind of this concurrence between, you know, lots of different seemingly disparate cultures. They've kind of popped up all over the place, right? And of course they do have some sort of iteration, you know, in the natural world, like giant lizards or dinosaur bones and things like this. But I can't really help but think about Jung and the collective unconscious. And he talks about dragons as being this kind of, as being representations of archetypes, right, of a collective unconscious. And maybe that's taking a step backwards, because in a lot of ways Jung was kind of the first structural archaeologist, or anthropologist, excuse me. I'm not an anthropologist, nor am I into psychoanalysis, but even before, like, Levi-Strauss, right, he was trying to kind of find these universalities, right, within the mind, like Levi-Strauss is trying to find universalities in narrative, right, mythological narratives and things like that. And first of all, I wonder if you put any stock into ideas of a collective unconscious, because it does seem to go against what I see as a kind of post-structural current that I saw in your talk as meaning not being something that's universal, something that's even within us, but something that's created by process, such as the process of reading, such as the process of reading aloud or reading silently. And so I wonder if you could talk about that, about collective unconsciousness or about non-collective unconsciousness, if you will. Thank you.
I do have difficulties with the notion of a collective unconscious. I have difficulty with the notion of the unconscious, but even more with the collective one. And it's true that I put forward a kind of processual, I suppose, structural way of thinking, but on the other hand, you're entirely right that it is odd that dragons pop up in so many different cultural contexts. Now, maybe just us, when we say, well, there's a Chinese dragon, and there's a Welsh dragon, and there's a Viking dragon, and I don't know whether you've got them here too, but they do pop up all over the place, whether it's just our wishful thinking that is pulling them all together under the same label, or whether there's something essential underneath that links them all. I was struck looking at some of the medieval depictions of dragons, and my first thought was they didn't look like much like a dragon to me. They often looked like a sort of bit like a kind of rat at the front and a snake at the back, and sort of pretty undragon-like things. Then I was working with one of our PhD students who's been working on North Atlantic seafaring, and so knows a lot about the references to dragons in the Norse material, Vikings, where actually the dragon was an ocean current. Around Iceland, for example, there's an ocean current that actually circles the island. And if you wanted to know where to make a settlement, you'd throw a log into the water and see where it floats ashore. I think that's probably a good place to build your harbour. And they were thinking of the dragon, actually, the coil of the serpent was actually the current of the sea. And if you were a sailor, you'd know all about it. So my own inclination would be to look in those kinds of directions rather than into the into earth, air, fire, and water, if you like, and their universality, rather than any kind of collective unconscious. It's the best I can do.
My name is Rachel, Raquel, and I'm an anthropologist, but I work with education. Okay, I have a two-folded question. First, when we look at these illuminators from medieval times, you have science, religion, and art together. And I think that I miss in this imagination dimension art that was all included in medieval times and also in other cultures that are not Western. And even in child development, you can see that there is lots of imagination until when they start learning to write, until literacy. And then there is a rupture, and art comes sometimes, but sometimes not. When science comes, imagination goes away. And the second part of my question is that even in science, that it's very fuzzy, the difference between dragons and all this anthropological research, Kazawari is a bird or not, it's not a bird, and dinosaurs and ETs, for instance. So all this has lots of imagination and into it, and art also. So how do you put these things together?
That's important and complicated. I absolutely agree with you that in modern education, when children really start writing, or of course when they're writing at a particular kind of level, then as you say, there's a rupture somewhere, and there's a rupture between, I think, the world and our imagination of it, that these two get pulled apart. And at the point where they get pulled apart, then art is seen as something, a sort of a domain of its own. It's like I said at the beginning, that we have this idea that we should have a space for the imagination somewhere, and put art in it, and put religion in it, and put indigenous worldviews in it, and all these kinds of things. But it's not nothing to do with reality, which is the stuff that's really important. And so, and you even have policymakers in Britain who say, why do we need the arts? Because it contributes to the UK economy through the entertainment industry. I mean, we'll stick it up there. You know, better have some art. But so something happens. There's this terrible rupture, and what I want to do is to find a way of healing that rupture, so that we can think of imagination not as something stuck on top or optional extra, or something you do when you're not writing, or that you do in your free periods at school. But actually, that imagination is part of the process of life itself. That it's what drives us, and. In modern education, that rupture comes where writing splits off from drawing. And I think the really interesting thing about medieval manuscripts is that you can't separate writing and drawing. It makes no sense. They could be drawing, they could be writing. They were drawing letters. Sometimes they were drawing pictures. There was no rupture between image and text. And it was the written line that somehow was bringing things in, that it was an imaginative line that was creating the world as it went. In just the same way as when you go, when you're walking along through a landscape. And they often, as I mentioned, compared writing or reading to hunting and following a trail. You're walking through a landscape following a trail. You're supposed to be creating the world as you go. And I think that medieval writers thought of the imagination in that way. And that's what way I want to get back to, and to try and counteract the theory of imagination that is built into modern educational practice, which sees it as something cut off from the real world. And I just want to say one more thing. I was reading in an article in a British publication of the Times Higher, written by a professor of cardiovascular medicine, talking about the relationship between university research in biology and the pharmaceutical industry, and regretting the fact that children were not getting as much exposure as they should at school to the arts and humanities. So they should have more arts and humanities. They'd be better scientists then if they go on to do biology. But what did he say? He said, because arts and humanities at school exposes children to fantasy, to stories, to myth, which will fire their imaginations, so that they can, which leads to those insights, those conjectures, which then could bear fruit in future scientific work. So he was still thinking in those sorts of terms, that there's the fantasy stuff you do, you calculate, you have your dream, but then there's the hard science that comes after that. Anyway.
Hello, I'm Luis Guilherme. Well, I read your anthropology as one that would like to keep going, that keep on moving, make the lecture, the reader keep going as the writer. And in this effort, I think you try to show us how lots of inversions was performed by the Western culture. You did so with materiality and materials. You did so with space and place and weather and ground, lots of things. And now we see another, I am seeing another inversion. Word. In this inversion, I would like to understand how to, because in all other inversions you showed us, you put us on moving. You put us to read your article on materiality, looking at a rock drawing, and things like this. You maybe you went to saw a plane, so things like this. Now, everybody here writes, and probably will write a book someday. And what about now? How to perform this reinversion? How to keep going on this act of writing? How to write in order to show that work and work was never separated? Does it? And a question: does it have to do with the way you think the relation between natives and anthropologists? And in fact, who are your natives?
My natives? I don't have any natives. I just have people. People. That's what I say. But you're actually right. It's a really crucial thing, and I don't know the answer to it. But I'm quite sure that there is something wrong with current conventions of academic writing. I think they're producing a kind of writing that is stale, that is not engaged in the way we would like it to be. There are enormous institutional pressures that force us to write in particular ways. in Britain we have research assessment exercises and things like that, which really distort it. But I'm in search of a way of writing that would, where we could say that the article, the book, is something that would enable us to see things or observe things or notice things in the world that we hadn't noticed before. And one often says of a good painting, you go to an art gallery and you see a particular painting, and you don't just look at it and say, what a pretty painting. What really matters is that that painting stays with you, and later on you suddenly find that you're noticing things that you hadn't noticed before. You say, how is it that I noticed these things? And then you realize that that painting has educated you, or caused you to realize something, whatever it might be, a color or a shape or something. And I wish we could write in that kind of a way, so that we don't. And this is the same issue about this question of relationship between knowing and being. The way things are at the moment, we treat the world as somewhere where we go to get our data, and then we bring it back and we process it and analyze it and we write it up in books, and then we teach our students, and students say, where am I going to, I want to become wiser, I want to become more knowledgeable. What do we tell them? Go and read the books. So we say, don't look at the world. No. Go and read the books. That's where the knowledge is. The world is just your raw material. And I think that is wrong. We need to turn it around so that we could show how the literature we write is part of a way of being. And by being, I mean being observant and aware of things that are going on around us. And so we have got to, I think, to write in a different way, but it's something that I've been trying to do with our students, to get them to write in that kind of way. But it's very difficult, and it goes against the grain of what is expected in the academic world. And people have their careers and have to pass exams, and so we're constrained in it. But I do think something has to be done. And so just creating these mountains of academic literature, which doesn't seem to relate to anything much. I think that this must be something wrong. So we need to put it right.
I presume you're very tired by now, I really enjoyed your talk. It's a very seductive talk, and I loved the lecture. But there's something that made me think of, well, let's put it like that. I think that it very well fits the kind of traditional knowledge that we are finding among the people we are working with. Right. So, for instance, Aboriginal societies in Brazil. I mean, they know exactly the way you describe it. I mean, learning and hunting, in a sense, are inseparable. And recently, there's a wonderful book that came out by David Kopenhauer and Bruce Albert, precisely on shamanic. I mean, it's David Kopenhauer, Yanomami, talking about how he acquires his knowledge. And it absolutely fits with your description. Where I have a problem, though, is there is a kind of moral message that you are delivering that, again, I find very seductive. But then I wonder if we can't understand or try to understand why modern science is as it is, and rather than deploring what it has lost, it's that undertone that I find problematic, and I don't know if you want to comment on that.
Yes, sir. You're right. I think there's such a difference between between science as an institution and just what people who call themselves scientists do. And actually, I don't have much of a problem with what people who call themselves scientists do. They're fascinated in all sorts of things. They explore it in very hunterly ways, actually. And I think the place where there really is a problem is in the institutionalization of science. And that means that it has to do with the relation between science and the state and with corporations. And so it eventually becomes a political issue. And I think that it's a political issue and not an ontological one. The reason why some ways of thinking that, as you say, would be second nature, absolutely obvious to many so-called indigenous people. I'm familiar with peoples of the Southern Polar North, but it's very similar. There are ways of thinking that are obvious to them, but carry very little power. And the reason for that, so far as I can judge, is because it's political. It has to do directly with the relationship between knowledge economy and the nation state, which also, I think, affects the way in which we educate our children. I think it's also incredibly important in all of this. So yes, I think my only answer is that once you start tackling the particular kind of question that you raised, then we're into the politics. And I didn't touch on the politics here, but one would have to take any further.
Thank you very much. Muito obrigado a todos. Nos vemos em breve, daqui a 2 anos, no próximo REC.